greet you all saints in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ. Amen. We're about to study a very, very serious message on the love cry, given the events that are transpiring on the earth today. I believe that this is a very, very important study that is going to show us how we ought to work as God's people. And I really believe that we need to work in this way. Otherwise, yeah, we are going to be rendered very, very useless to the Lord and also to the world around us. But before we begin our study, let's just begin with a word of prayer. Righteous Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we come before your holy throne. We really, really thank you so much for the opportunity that you have given to us to study your word now. Please, Heavenly Father, make things clear, make them plain as we peruse through your word. And as there are many people are sick, as many people are confused, many people are afraid, I really plead for your Holy Spirit to speak to each and every heart, Lord. Please bring comfort, bring healing, and bring warning, Lord, as we are in a very, very contentious and perilous time. Please, Heavenly Father, I pray that you may really speak directly to us. And I'm just asking God for the forgiveness of my sins, also the sins of all those who have listened. Please, Heavenly Father, be merciful unto us. And I'm asking God, knowing that mercy is something that you find delight in. So I know that, Lord, you are ready to forgive even now, and you are ready to help us, Lord, as your remnant church. I ask all of these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Saints, we are going to be studying something very, very special today. And to begin our study, let us go to the book of Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24. There is something that I really, really want us to see. This is such an important chapter. Matthew, the 24th chapter. Okay, almost there. Now in Matthew chapter 24, you find Jesus speaking to the disciples. And then they ask him a certain question. Notice, it says in verse 1, and Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, see ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. Do you see the first prophecy that Jesus gives in Matthew 24 is actually the destruction of Jerusalem, the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem, together with the entire city as well. That was the first prophecy that Jesus gave in Matthew 24. And then Jesus continues to give other prophecies. He says in verse 5 that there will come false Christs. And then he says in verse 6 that there will be wars and rumors of wars. I just want us to see these things. The destruction of Jerusalem, first of all, has it come to pass? As we can see on the slide, saints, the destruction of Jerusalem happened exactly as Jesus predicted it would happen. The temple was destroyed in AD 70, as you can see in the slide. And you can see, saints, it was not a funny moment. People lost their lives in very, very terrible ways. And history tells us, and the book Great Controversy tells us, that the Roman legions that were there, they had no respect either for life, whether it is of the young or of the old, whether it is of a woman or a man. They killed everything. As you can see on the slide, people are even getting thrown over very high buildings and tops. So it was very, very terrible. And Jesus predicted this. And you see also Jesus in verse 6, he predicts that we shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. And then he says, see that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. So there have been wars since the time that Jesus has left the earth going to heaven. And I've just shown here the first world war. in 1914, ending in 1918. And then soon after that, there was a Second World War. Many lives were lost. This is still the First World War. Then the Second World War, beginning in 1939, ending in 1945. Lives upon lives were lost. As you can see here, many, many graves of people who died in these warfares. But Jesus says something that as you see these wars, the end is not yet. And then he transitions and he goes to verse 7. Notice with me now in verse 7, saints. Jesus says, for nation shall rise against nation, and there shall be what? Famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places. Then verse 8 says, these are the beginning of sorrows. Other versions say these are the beginning of birth pains. Now I want to ask you something. When a woman is pregnant, because that is where the analogy of birth pains comes from. When a woman is pregnant, when does she experience birth pains? Is it in the first month? Is it in the second month? Is it in the third month? Is it in the fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh? When is it? It is just before the baby is born. Are you with me, saints? Right before the baby is born. And Jesus says that the events portrayed in verse 7, these are the beginning of birth pains. When they begin to transpire, we should know that the end is near, even at the door. And how birth pains work, we all know. They become more frequent and more severe the closer you get to the delivery of the child. So likewise, the signs of the times, these signs, the famines, the wars, the pestilences, the natural disasters, all of them will get worse and worse as you approach the coming of Jesus Christ. And all of them, saints, as I show you now in the slides, they tell of one thing and one thing only, that the Jesus is at the door. Really, when we see the signs, we should be hearing the footsteps of an approaching God, saints. We should be hearing the footsteps of an approaching God. We should be knowing that the Savior who died for us is near, even at the door. So wars happened, World War I, World War II. But you know that today, saints, as we're speaking, there are wars happening. And as you can see what I've just shown in the slide, this is a table that is showing the number of nations that are at war. The first one here, this is now in Asia, in Afghanistan. And it has the years where these wars have been happening. But look now to your far, far right. Do you see that the fatalities of these wars in the first one, 19,444? Do you see that, saints? So even this year, while other nations were on lockdown, trying to fight the COVID-19 and all of these other things that are happening in the countries that are in a mess, there are certain countries which have been in a warfare. As you go down the list, there are so many. I did not take the entire table. I just took three nations. But I wanted to show you, saints, that war is continuing. And now, saints, it is so, so frequent. Like, it is warfare non-stop. Let me just put it like that. And the reason why many people think that there is no war, it is because either there is no war in their country, also it is because some of these warfares, they have now been removed from international media. So many people do not know of them, except the people who are staying there. But the world is in a state of war. The world is in a state of warfare. And not only that, Jesus said that there will be famines as well. Notice the slide. Famines. People queuing for food. Hunger. Killing many. And as you can see here, children having something like tickets asking for food. Oh, saints, look at the next one. Children almost dying of starvation. And this is the case in many, many countries. And I believe that many more countries, especially as the UN has announced that many, many more countries, saints, are going to enter into a state of poverty in the years to come. So we are seeing famines, and famines are increasing. Just like how birth pains are supposed to increase the closer you get to the birth of the child. Are you with me? And not only that, Jesus told us that there would also be what? Natural disasters. Look at this. This is an earthquake that happened recently. Actually, this is in this year. As you can see, the date is November 2, 2020. So these are the first few days of the earthquakes, and already 57 are dead. And you can see buildings being destroyed. People crying. Because loved ones have been lost. And Jesus says, by this you may know that his coming is near, even at the doors. But Jesus says something else as well, saints, as one of the signs of the times. In verse 9, speaking to us as Christians, he says, then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. And we know that this is the same event as that portrayed in the book of Revelation, chapter 13, the National Sunday Law. And we see, according to the signs of the times, saints, again, that we are really, really heading to these times. As we see the Pope accepting many of the things that religious people ought not to accept, we know that even this event, the persecution of the saints, is at the door, saints. We're heading to these times. So basically, I want to say this, that all the events, saints, that we see around us, they are telling us that the coming of Jesus is near even at the door. Near even at the door. Like, things cannot last much longer the way they are. I really believe that we are hearing some of the last sermons that we will ever hear. Things are changes, great changes are soon to take place upon the earth. And the final movements will be rapid ones. That's Last Day Events, page 11. We're told that great changes are soon to take place upon the earth, and the final movements will be rapid ones. But you know, saints, even though we see all of these signs pointing to the fact that Jesus is coming and he is near at the door, there is one sign, however, that seems to be out of sync with all of these other signs. Let me show you something. Jump with me to verse 14. Verse 14. Jesus says, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. Do you hear that? So Jesus is saying that before the end comes, which the signs affirm that it's really near. But Jesus says that before the end comes, this gospel of the kingdom must be preached in all the world for a witness unto how many nations? All nations. Then shall the end come. Now, in our time, the gospel of the kingdom is the three angels' messages. So Jesus is saying that the three angels' messages must fill the entire world before Jesus can come with the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. Are you hearing that, saints? You know, when I first had this thought, it really troubled me a lot, because I could see very clearly, as I've just showed now in a nutshell, that all of the signs are pointing to the fact that we're at the end, and there is no other end except this end, saints. We're truly, truly at the end. Yet I've been troubled because I'm asking myself, Lord, the three angels' messages to the entire world before you come, it would then seem to suppose that, you know, we need to wait here for another 100, 200 years. But the signs are not saying that. Then what could be the problem? How in the world is this going to happen? That the three angels' message is going to fill the entire world in the next few years, in the next few months, and then Jesus comes. How is that going to happen? Because that's what all the signs are showing. And look at these things. On top of what I'm just saying, I want to show you now the figures, we're speaking now about figures, mathematics, statistics. Look at the population of the world. The current world population is almost 8 billion people in the world. And as you see here on the column on your right, on the bottommost figure, this is the population growth this year. This is for 2020. It's almost 81 million. I think when the year ends, it's going to be more than that. So let's just suppose it's 81 million. So first of all, there's almost 8 billion people upon the world today. And year by year, people are growing. 81 million people every year. That's the increase of the population every year. And do you know what is the number of Seventh-day Adventists? Let me show you things. Oh, this is in small writing, but I hope you'll be able to see it. This is now the figures in 2019. This is actually found in the website of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, our church. And this is a website that just shows the statistics of the church. Many things you'll find here. What I looked at is the church membership. And notice down here in 2019, the church membership is just 21 million. Just 21 million. Compared to a world population that is almost 8 billion. Can you believe it, saints? Do you know what a billion is? 1 billion. 1 billion is 1,000 millions. 1 billion is 1,000 times a million. That's 1 billion. So 8 billion basically would be what? 8,000 million. And the church is only sitting at 21 million compared to the 8,000 million of the world. Do the math for yourself. It's 21 over 8,000. The percentage of people who have embraced the three angels' messages, it's less than 0.001%. It's very, very small. Yet Jesus says this gospel of the kingdom must fill the entire world before he comes. How can that happen? I mean, saints, let's say we're not even looking now at the 8 billion people in the world. Out of the 21 million people in the church, there is just a handful, just a few. There is just a few saints, even in the church, there is just a few who really know the three angels' messages and are practicing it and are sharing it with others. So how can it happen that the words of Jesus will be fulfilled, that the three angels' message will spread to the entire world before it comes, even in this generation? Because I've shown you in previous studies, saints, that indeed we are the last generation. But how will this happen? How will this happen, saints? Are we going to be here for another 1,000 years? Cannot be. I showed you from the Bible and from the spirit of prophecy and from the events that we are the last generation. And look at the growth. I'm going to show you the slide now again. Look at the growth in 2019, from 2018 to 2019, of the church. It's 0.66%. And do you know what the growth will be from 2019 to 2020? I don't know as well. But I'm expecting it's even going to be a negative growth. Since because of this pandemic, there have been no evangelistic efforts. I don't know. I hope it's not. But I'm just thinking that it's going to be like that. So you see that our numbers are even getting fewer. Yet Jesus says, the gospel is going to be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations before he comes. How shall it happen? Let me show you something, saints, that really, really, you know, that harmonized everything so powerfully. I want to show you something. Come with me to the book of Mark chapter 3. How will we as a church in this generation make sure that the gospel spreads? The three angels' messages with Christ at the center of it all. How will we make sure that it spreads to all the almost 8 billion people in the world? And the 8 million per year that are increasing. How will we make sure that it happens like that? Oh, saints, this is so amazing. Come with me to Mark chapter 3. Remember, as a church, the prophecy does not say that we are going to convert the entire world, but it says that we are going to, the entire world must hear this gospel. Because when Jesus comes very, very soon, the world will be polarized into two groups. Those who have the mark of the beast and those who have the seal of God, and everyone, before they can have these, must know the gospel. And they must see it, and they must then decide. Now, how will that happen? Let me show you something, saints. Mark chapter 3. I'm going to read from verse 7. Here it speaks about the popularity of Jesus. Before I read this, I want to tell you that Jesus began his public ministry in the year AD 27. Now, when you get to Mark chapter 3 in verse 7, this is in the year AD 29. So it's just under 2 years, basically, from the time he began his ministry. But I want us to see how popular Jesus was. It says in verse 7, read with me, "But Jesus withdrew himself with his disciples to the sea, and a great multitude from Galilee followed him, and from Judea, and from Jerusalem, and from Idumea, and from beyond Jordan, and they about Tyre and Sidon, a great multitude, when they had heard what great things he did, came unto him." Do you hear that, saints? Jesus was teaching from Galilee to Judea to Perea, all of these places. And we are told that under 2 years, Jesus had covered this entire nation. And not only the entire nation, but even other places surrounding the nation. Because when you look at Tyre and Sidon, it's up there in the north. And Idumea is right there in the south part. It's even below Judea, as you can see in the map. And many people came to him. Even the Bible says from beyond Jordan as well. So you look at on your right, the pass of Decapolis. Now this is under 2 years. Less than 2 years. The ministry of Jesus had caught nationwide fame and was even spreading to nations that are beyond Palestine. How did Jesus do this? In a time where there was no Facebook, no YouTube, no newspapers, like how was Jesus able to accomplish this task in just under 2 years, where the gospel and his fame reaches the entire nation and even borders outside that nation? I'll tell you how I was able to do it, saints. The Bible tells us in Luke chapter 3, verse 22, that Jesus was full of the Holy Ghost. Jesus was full of the Holy Ghost. Also, Acts chapter 10, I think it's in verse 28, where it says that Jesus was anointed with the Holy Ghost and went about doing good. Are you with me? That is how Jesus caught the fame, the attention of all these nations and of all these places in Palestine within less than just 2 years. This is one person. So Jesus is actually showing us how much one person full of the Holy Ghost can do, such that the gospel can reach an entire nation, saints. An entire nation. Let me show you that this was not true of Jesus only. Come with me to the book of Acts chapter 19. Acts chapter 19. All saints, I hope we are seeing this. The power of the Holy Ghost. The power of going about doing good. Acts chapter 19. It's speaking now about Paul. I'll begin in verse 8. It says, "And he went into the synagogue and spake boldly for the space of 3 months, disputing and persuading the things concerning the kingdom of God. But when divers were hardened," meaning when others were hardened, "and believed not, but spake evil of that way before the multitude, he departed from them and separated the disciples, disputing daily in the school of one Tyrannus." Now listen to verse 10. "And this continued by the space of how many years? 2 years. So that all they which dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord Jesus, both Jews and Greeks." Whoa, let us pause there. This is Paul when he was in Ephesus. We are told that in the space of 2 years, Paul's ministry was so widespread that the Bible says all which dwelt about in Asia heard the gospel of Jesus. Are you with me, saints? In less than 2 years. Okay, this one says in the space of 2 years, those which dwelt in Asia heard the gospel. I mean, there are people who have been staying in places. You find that you are staying not in a country. Asia, it's more than just one country. Many, many countries have heard the gospel, according to the Bible, within just a space of 2 years. Yet when you find with us, someone might be staying in a location somewhere, maybe Mlaz, and in a small section from Mlaz, maybe Kwa-F, Kwa-R, and yet you have been staying there for 10 years, and yet not the entire population in that place has heard the three angels' message from your mouth. Not the entire population in that place has seen the three angels' message exemplified in your life. Some people would even ask, what is the three angels' message? And when you're looking for a Seventh-day Adventist church around, they would ask, what church is that? Can you see, saints, how behind we are? Yet, Paul, we are told, in the space of just 2 years, was able to fill the entire Asia, with the gospel of Jesus. What was the difference? Again, I tell you, Paul was full of the Holy Ghost. He was being used by the Holy Spirit. And I want to tell you, saints, from the stats that we looked at, more than 7 billion people in the world, and the church just numbering at a lousy 21 million. Even the population growth per year is almost 4 times the entire number of the entire church. So it's clear that in the way that we are doing things, we are never going to finish the work. We are never going to finish the work. We need, saints, new methods, which are not new at all, which God has told them to us long before this time. And I'm going to share them today. And we need the Holy Spirit. Do you know why Jesus was able to do what he did? It's because he was full of the Holy Spirit. But not only that. Do you remember in the book of Luke chapter 2 verse 49? When the parents of Jesus were looking for him, he said to them, "How is it that you sought me? Wist ye not that I must be about my Father's business?" The reason why Jesus was able to labor so effectively is because he was about his Father's business. The reason why our labor is attended with such poor results is because we are busy with all other business except our Father's business. People are trying to get rich doing this and that and many other things. Yet the Father's business is being neglected. And I'm not saying that people should not have businesses, but make sure that your business is the Father's business. Whatever proceeds you might be getting from your business or from your employment, and even your presence in that employment, must be about the Father's business, the spreading of the gospel, the three angels' messages, saints. Unless we do that, since we are not going to finish the work. And from what we see here, from what we've just studied, saints, God is not looking for many people. I mean, Jesus was one man and a few disciples that he was still training. Yet he was able to do this work within just 2 years. So God is not looking for many people. He's looking for just a few people who will say, "I want to be about my Father's business." Many people are taking this work like a hobby. Something on the side when I have spare time. This is not a hobby. This is the main purpose, the main object of Christianity and our conversion. If it is not, then we are not converted. I mean, Jesus left heaven to save the world. How can it be that those who are converted and who call themselves the servants and the disciples of Jesus, They are treating this as a hobby. Jesus said also in the book of John chapter 4 in verse 34, he said, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. Are you with me? Jesus had no other joy except the joy of doing the work of God. The reason why the work of God in these days is attended with such poor results is that very, very few people are what Jesus was. Even Paul as well. This is what Paul was. Let me show you something. Let's go to the book of Acts chapter 9. I want to show you why was the Holy Spirit able to use Paul so effectively. So that as we prepare saints for the latter rain, which I believe is about to fall in great, great measure, we should have this in mind. God cannot use anyone whose mind is being filled with all other businesses except this business. There is coming a time, and it has come even now, where to all those who want to continue in their worldliness, making money, and forgetting what God wants us to do, God is going to say, continue with your business. I am going to use people who want to continue with my business. Notice Paul. I want to show you why is it that the Holy Spirit was able to do so much with the Apostle Paul. Acts chapter 9, Paul at his conversion. I'll read in verse 6. It says, and he trembled, and he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? Let's pause there. This is Paul speaking. What wilt thou have me to do? What wilt thou have me to do? This is Paul speaking. And saints, if ever we want to be full of the Holy Spirit, this should be the attitude. Many of us, when we are converted, we don't go to Jesus and say, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? Many of us, we say, Lord, can I still continue doing this? Can I still continue? We ask for permission to continue with the aspirations and with the dreams that we had even before we were converted. And that is not conversion, saints. True conversion is laying aside your plans and saying, Lord, what plans would you have me to carry out now? Are you with me? A great deal of what people call religion today, it's actually them begging God to permit them to continue with their own plans, rather than to say, as Paul said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? So, saints, what I am really, really pleading with you, this is also a plea that the Holy Spirit has been making to me in my own heart. Let us have our lives to be fully surrendered to Jesus and say, Lord, what would you have us to do at this time? Let us not move by policy. Let us not move by what the government is saying. That is not how the disciples of Jesus ought to act. We ought to be moving under the direction of the Holy Spirit, and we need to be pleading for guidance from the Lord. Lord, what would you have me to do? Are you with me, saints? And until we get to this point, I'm afraid, saints, that many, many, many of the people in the church will be rendered useless in the hands of the Lord, and God is going to pass them by and is going to use others. Don't think that just because you are not surrendered, you are having all of these other plans, this work won't continue. This work will continue. But you and your father's house will perish. Do you remember what Mordecai said to Esther in the book of Esther chapter 4? He said, if you are going to hold your peace, if you are going to keep quiet at this time, salvation and deliverance will come to Israel from another place. But you and your father's house and your house, you will perish. Are you with me, saints? And the same call comes down to us now. If you will keep quiet, and if you will just sit down folding your hands at such a time as this, you and your father's house will perish. But salvation will come to the people of God from other places, from other people who are willing to be servants, who are willing to be used by the Lord, who are willing to lay anything and everything aside, who are willing to be made anything and even nothing for the sake of Jesus. All saints, Jesus left heaven for us. Just let that sink in for a moment. Jesus descended from the throne of the universe and he came to this earth. Imagine the humiliation. I mean, angels were amazed. Just imagine, saints, Jesus being the commander of the entire universe. But there came a point in time when he, who was used to sending angels around, go there, go there. Now he was a child being sent by weak and feeble humans. Mary and Joseph sending Jesus, my child, go there, do that. You know, angels were amazed to see the humiliation of Jesus. Amazed to see his condescension. And yet, so few of us are willing to condescend as Jesus condescended. Let me show you now, saints, how the loud cry comes into the picture. The loud cry is actually God's promise in the book of Revelation that God will have such a people. People who are willing to be used in this manner, and this work will be finished. I hope we have seen from the experience of Jesus and Paul that it's possible that to finish this work, to cover all of these 8 billion people in the world in just a few short months and even in just a few short years. But we need to be like how Jesus and Paul were. Come with me to Revelation chapter 18. I want us to see something, saints. I want us to see something. Revelation, the 18th chapter. Now listen to this very carefully. It says, and after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having a great what? Great power. And the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried mightily or powerfully with a strong voice or with a powerful voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and is become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings have committed fornication with her. And the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. Verse 5, for her sins have reached unto heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities. Pause there. This is the message that we call the loud cry. Because we are told that the angel cries in a powerful voice or in a loud voice. Are you with me, saints? Now there is something that I want us to see here. In verse 1 and verse 2, there is a word that is continuously repeated. And this word signifies something in the Bible. I will read again. And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having what? Great power. And the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried powerfully with a powerful voice. What is the word that is continuously repeated and that is emphasized? Power. Power. This angel is coming down with great power, crying powerfully with a powerful voice. Like, it's like everything is just full of power. Are you with me? Now, according to the Bible, where do we as people of God get power? Acts chapter 1 verse 8 tells us, and ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you. Are you with me? So power comes through the presence. the abundant presence of the Holy Spirit. Are you with me, saints? So before the loud cry is given, before the loud cry is given, the Holy Spirit must come upon the people of God with a very, very mighty power. Also, you find this as well in the book of Micah chapter 3 in verse 8, that power comes from the Holy Spirit. So throughout the entire Bible, Old and New Testament, power comes by the abundant presence of the Holy Spirit. Without the abundant presence of the Spirit of God, and without our submitting of our lives to the Spirit of God, there is going to be no power. And unless we make the surrender that we've been speaking about, we will not partake in this loud cry, saints. Are you with me? Now, we have studied in a previous study that the latter rain, the abundant outpouring of the Holy Spirit, comes after the National Sunday Law. Are you with me? So this loud cry calling people to exit Babylon, even though people can be called now verbally, but it will not have an effect as it will have according to this chapter, unless we are filled with the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit, saints, we are told that the latter rain comes after the National Sunday Law. So that's the timing of the loud cry message. We are filled with the Holy Spirit. That's the latter rain that comes first. And then we give the what? The loud cry message. Let me just show you. Notice the slide on the screen. And also, by the way, something else before I take you to the screen. Before the loud cry can be given, another thing that has to happen is that Babylon's sins must reach to heaven and Babylon must be fully fallen. Are you with me? Because the loud cry is saying that Babylon is fallen, and their sins have reached unto heaven. That's verse 5. So two things are required: the latter rain and the full falling of Babylon before the loud cry is given. Now notice here in last day events, page 198, when Babylon shall be fully fallen, and when Babylon shall have made every nation fully drunk of the wine of the wrath of fornication. Notice, she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of fornication. Revelation 14, verse 6 to 8. How is this done? Question mark. And then the answer: by forcing men to accept a spurious Sabbath. Let's pause there, saints. So we find here, according to last day events, page 198, the way in which Babylon makes every nation drink of the wine of the wrath of fornication. It's by forcing men to accept what? A spurious Sabbath. Have men been forced now? The forcing has not come, because the force will come by legislation and by persecution. So it's clear then that not yet can it be said that every nation has drunk of the wine of the wrath of fornication. The quotation continues: not yet, however, can it be said that she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. She has not yet made all nations do this. Not until this condition shall be reached, and the union of the church with the world shall be fully accomplished throughout Christendom, will the fall of Babylon be completed. The change is a progressive one, and the perfect fulfillment of Revelation chapter 14 verse 8 is yet future. Do you see that, saints? Let me continue and read another one. This is now from Signs of the Times, June 12, 1893. The Signs of the Times, June 12, 1893. Listen to what it says. When do her sins reach unto heaven? It continues, when the law of God is finally made void by legislation. Do you hear that? So the sins of Babylon can only be said to reach heaven when the law of God is finally made void by legislation. And now, saints, it is about at that point. We have almost reached that point. The point of the National Sunday Law. When the law of God is made void by legislation, when the laws of the nation will forbid people to worship on the Sabbath, we see already that the laws of the nation have reached
a very draconian state, very, very forceful, and there is no consultation at all, or very, very little consultation at all, with the public and democracy. Are you with me? And what we are seeing happening now under this COVID-19 crisis, we are going to see very soon happening under the National Sunday Law. People now are being prepared by the government to accept whatever the government says, because it is for common good. Are you with me, saints? So I've just shown you the quotations which show us that the loud cry is going to begin sounding. It's going to begin sounding after the National Sunday Law. The loud cry which is calling people out of Babylon. Out of Babylon fully. Even though now as well people may be called out by messages, and we ought to be calling people out. Yes, that's true. But that is not in the fullest sense the loud cry. It's not the loud cry. We are still preaching the first, the second, and the third angel's message. But the loud cry, when the third angel's message shall swell into the loud cry, saints, we are going to see things that we have never seen before. And one of the reasons why as well God is waiting until the National Sunday Law to do this work is because, remember from our previous study of the shaking, that the final shaking will take place during the National Sunday Law crisis. This is when many people whom God has not appointed will be weeded out. Remember, selected messages, volume 3, page 385. This great crisis so near at hand will weed out those whom God has not appointed, and he will have a true, pure, sanctified ministry prepared for the latter rain. So the final crisis that shakes people out is the National Sunday Law. Do you know what would happen if God would bring in people in their numbers now in the church? Many people would go back in the world, because as the church of God currently, we are so divided and we are so backslidden, saints. It is not even funny. So even though God wants us to spread the gospel now, but God is not now working to bring many people in the church. In fact, this reminds me about a quotation. In the book Testimonies to the Church, volume 6, page 370, it says, "The Lord does not now work to bring many into the church or into the truth. Why? Because of the unconverted members, and because of those who were once converted but have backslidden. What influence would these unconsecrated members have upon new converts? Would they not make of none effect the God-given message which his people must bear?" So do you see that God is not now working to bring many into the church? Why? Because of the unconverted members, and because of those who were once converted and have backslidden. So before God can do what he did during Pentecost under the early rain, God needs to first shake the church. That's why the church even back then was shaken, and Judas, who was a false disciple, was shaken out. And he was shaken out by the crisis, remember, of the cross. And likewise with us, the shaking is going to happen through the crisis. The final shaking is going to happen through the crisis of the National Sunday Law. And then God will begin to work marvelously for his people. Marvelously. Now, I want to show you something. Now, this is preparation. This is the preparation that we need to have. What I'm going to show you now is the preparation that we need to have in order for us to be part of the loud cry that is soon about to begin, saints. Soon about to begin. Revelation chapter 18. Let's read that verse again. It says, "And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory." Are you with me? Let us pause here. So we find that before the loud cry is given of saying the people must come out of Babylon, first of all, the earth is lightened with the what? With the glory of God. It is brightened with the glory of God. What is the glory of God? It is his character. Are you with me, saints? So before the loud cry is given, what makes preparation for the cry to be given? It is actually the lightening or the brightening of the entire world with the character of God. And what is the character of God? God is love. God is love. So what prepares the world for the loud cry message, saints? It is actually the demonstration of the love of God in the lives of those who are to give the loud cry message. Are you with me, saints? And we're told here that the earth was lightened with the glory of God, meaning this is something that people saw. Are you with me? Because we don't hear light, we see light. So meaning, people will not only hear about the love of God. There are many people who have preached powerfully about the love of God. But it is sad to say that there are very few people who have demonstrated powerfully in their lives the love of God. Yet we are told here that prior to the loud cry sounding, there will be found a group of people. It might not be many. It might not be many, I repeat. It might be just a few. But we are told that they are going to brighten the world with the glory of God. They are going to reveal the character of God. Are you with me, saints? And do you know that the character of God is simply revealed by revealing Christ? It is simply revealed by a Christ-like life. It takes more than just a loud voice to give the loud cry. If all it took was a loud voice to give the loud cry, you can see how loud I am. Long before this, I would have been giving the loud cry. Are you with me? But it takes more than that. It takes sacrifice. Complete surrender, wholehearted surrender, thrusting your life and throwing it in the furrow of the world's need, displaying and demonstrating the love of Christ to its fullest. And what is the love of Christ? Jesus leaving heaven, leaving the place of his comfort, leaving the place of his wealth, leaving his wealth and becoming poor so that other people may find salvation. Are you with me, saints? Who is willing to do this work? Heaven is waiting for people to use, people with whom to cooperate to do this work. And this work, saints, of revealing the character and the glory of Jesus, it's none other than the medical missionary work. I want to show you something. I want to show you something. There is a message. I want to show you something. There is a message that came in 1888. And when you read in this quotation that I've just shown now on the screen, this quotation says that this message is actually the beginning of the loud cry. How can it be that this is the beginning of the loud cry, whereas other quotations were telling us that the loud cry can only come when the sins have reached unto heaven, and this can only be at the inaction of the National Sunday Law? All of this just sounds confusing. How can it be? How can it be? Someone is asking themselves. But let me explain, saints. As I've shown you in this verse, the loud cry begins first of all with the character before the cry. It is the character, the demonstration of the love and the character of Jesus before the cry is made. So in 1888, God gave a message to us as a people that should actually enable us to reveal the character of Jesus. This is a message of the love of Jesus and his righteousness. And this is the message that was to prepare the people and still is to prepare people to give the loud cry. No one is going to give a loud cry whose heart is not throbbing with a love for God and a love for perishing humanity. Are you with me, saints? Now I want to show you that this message is actually supposed to create medical missionaries. Well, the best way of revealing the character of Jesus is through medical missionary work. Let me show you this quotation, saints. I am reading now in the book Medical Ministry, page 318. It says, there is a great work to be done. How shall we reveal Christ? So the work to be done is the revelation of Christ. But how shall we reveal Christ? Then the woman continues and says, I know of no better way than to take hold of the medical missionary work in connection with the ministry. Do you hear that, saints? The woman of God, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, says, I know of no better way of revealing Christ than to take hold of the medical missionary work in connection with the ministry. So if ever we want to reveal Jesus to the fullest, if ever we want to brighten the world with the glory of God, because the glory of God shines through the face of Jesus. So if ever we want to reveal Jesus' things, we are told that we need to take hold of the medical missionary work in connection with the ministry. So not only are we supposed to be preaching as I am doing now, but also we are to be practically demonstrating what we are saying. Are you with me? There are people who have lost faith in God and they have lost confidence in all men. Yet they still appreciate works of helpfulness and of sympathy. And when they see a medical missionary entering their doorsteps without any inducement of worldly praise or of monetary compensation, the people are touched with how this person is coming to help me here with this. And they're spending so much time and so much effort in trying to help me or trying to help a family member. Yet there is no praise of man that is going to get, and there is no money that I'm offering. People are touched. They see the character of Jesus. When they see someone losing time and perhaps even losing money, so that those people who need the help might get help, they are touched. And the earth is being brightened with the glory of God. Are you with me, saints? The woman of God says, I know of no better way. There might be many ways of revealing Jesus. We might be studying. We might be sharing the word. But she says, there is no better way than to take hold of the medical missionary work in connection with the ministry. Are you with me? Let me read another quotation for you. It says, the gospel and the medical missionary work are to advance together. The gospel is to be bound up with the principles of true health reform. And then it says, true Bible religion is an outflowing of the love of God for fallen men. Are you with me, saints? People have a very distorted character about God. That's why people are not being converted. And that's why some people are half converted. It's because people do not understand or know the love of God. And it is going to take more than just speaking about it to convince them. People need to see it now. People need to see it. The love of God. Remember that the only power with which God draws souls to himself is the power of love. It's the power of love. Don't you remember Jeremiah chapter 31? I think it's in verse 3. Where Jeremiah says, the Lord hath appeared of old unto me, saying, yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn thee. So God draws us to himself with what? With loving kindness. So when people do not see or know the depth and the breadth of the immense love of Jesus, they cannot be drawn to him. It might be as well that as you are listening or watching, it might be that some of the compromises in your own life as well have been due to the fact that you have not fully comprehended the immense love of Jesus. Oh, saints, I really believe with all my heart, when you have been gripped with the depth of the love of Jesus, who left heaven and hung on the cross for us, sin will become distasteful. Compromise will become hateful. We will hate compromising. Because we will realize how much the salvation has cost. We'll realize how much sin has cost the Son of God. We will not want to even smell it. But that's only if we are touched by the love of Jesus. That's why the medical missionary work at this time, saints, is so important. And let me share this thought with you as well. You see now, as we have entered into a state of lockdowns and pandemics, don't think it's going to get any better. Any person who wants to do a work for Jesus, but they don't want to do medical missionary work, they just better sit down. Because we are coming to a time, saints, where there will be no other work, there will be no other way of accessing people except through coming to heal them first. Are you with me? I mean, during this pandemic, I've been having access to so many homes. I mean, truly, I'm still a child in medical missionary work. I am really, really learning. But even in the little that the Lord has taught me, I've been having access to so many homes during this pandemic. Access that I was never going to have had it not been for the medical missionary work. And the Lord has really, really blessed these feeble efforts that these feeble hands have been able to do. Because their power is in Jesus. So saints, the work that we need to take upon ourselves, it is the medical missionary work, a work of real self-denial. Instead of doing self-studies, Bible studies, speaking about self-denial, we need to now exemplify these things. And the earth will be brightened with the glory of God. Are you with me? There is no one who is going to give the loud cry except they are engaged in medical missionary work. Now someone might be saying, oh, but does this mean that the entire church must be now engaged in medical missionary work? Yes, saints. Notice this quotation. It says, this I'm now reading in Testimonies to the Church, Volume 7, page 62. It says, we have come to a time when every member of the church should take hold of medical missionary work. Do you hear that? There is a house filled with victims of both physical and spiritual disease. Take up the work for which you are held responsible. The work that should be done in your home and in your neighborhood. Wait not for others to urge you to action. Are you with me? According to this quotation, look at it. How many people must take hold of this work? According to what is Jesus saying to us? Isn't it believe and know that the spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Jesus? So this is Jesus speaking. What is Jesus saying to us? Jesus is saying, we have come to a time when every member of the church should take hold of medical missionary work. What does that say to you, saints? We need to then begin inquiring of the Lord. Lord, how can I do this work? And we need to be finding training. We need to be finding training. And I really believe that because we've come to a time when we need to do this work, I believe that by God's providence, there is going to be abundant training for such a work. Because if we are not going to do this work, saints, we can forget about reaching people. Because as you are speaking, people are indoors, they are afraid of viruses. And the only way you can enter their doors and their homes is if you are coming with help. If you're coming with help. And we're told that we can do this work even in our homes. Do you see why the work requires so much self-denial? Because it means that instead of having a nice luxurious home where you're having extra rooms, one room for a child, one room for this, there's a room for everything. You need to clear some of the rooms and make them rooms for patients. And as you get training on this wonderful work, on this wonderful ministry, you then begin to take people into your home, cook for them, and you give them the, you administer to them the remedies that the Lord has told us that we can use them in faith without a denial of faith. And also you pray with the people, pray and pray. You have devotion to them. So you see that the entire home becomes a missionary for winning souls to Jesus. But it means that the home, saints, will never be the same again. And this is what many people are unwilling to do. They are unwilling to sacrifice their homes. They love leisure and pleasure too much. They love television too much. Because there is no way you are going to bring people over and evangelize them while you are playing Obosmayon and Generations on TV. That is hypocrisy. So it's clear that those things must go. But because we love self too much, and we have no love for Jesus. Many people are unwilling to do this work. And I will tell you the truth, as I have been saying it, God is going to pass many people by. Many, many people by. But those who are willing to surrender everything and anything, I urge you to take up this work. Oh, saints, I've really had some wonderful experiences in this work, even though, as I'm saying, I'm really a learner. But with the little and the feeble hands that I've been using, God has been able to teach so much. So much. This is truly, truly the work of God, I can guarantee you. And in closing, I want to just say this, saints, as you can see on the slide. Jesus said in John chapter 12, in verse 32, "And I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me." The only way that people will be drawn to Jesus as we want them to be drawn, it's if Jesus is lifted up. It's if Jesus is lifted up in our lives. It's if Jesus, his self-sacrifice, his love, his unselfishness is depicted and demonstrated in our lives, people will be shocked. I tell you the truth. People will be spellbound. And people will be ready to listen to what you have to say. This is the entering word of the gospel. This is the preparation of the hearts of the people to receive this heart-searching message that we have to bear, saints. If you're not willing to learn this work and take it up, God is going to pass you by. You will not receive the letter rain. Oh, saints, may God really help us. Look at that. Jesus hanging on the cross. Thorns on his head. This is the King of the universe. There has never been a greater demonstration of self-sacrifice, of condescension, and of self-denial as we see upon the cross of Calvary. Never. Never, saints. And Jesus is asking us to follow in his steps. First, beginning now with the medical missionary work. Beginning now. And this is the work that prepares us for the loud cry of message. Oh, saints, I want to appeal to you. Those who say, "I want to surrender my life fully," we are really, really at the end, saints. Those who say, "I want to surrender my life fully to Jesus," make a commitment now as you are about to pray. These, I believe, saints, are some of the last appeals that we are ever going to hear as a church. These are some of the last appeals. Time is almost finished. We need to respond. We need to respond. Those who say, "Lord, I'm struggling with television. I'm struggling with diet." Because you cannot be a medical missionary and you have not accepted health reform and dress reform. Those who say, "I'm struggling with all of these things, and I just want to surrender everything," make a commitment now as you pray. Those who say, "I'm holding grudges, and I don't have the forgiveness that Jesus has," make a commitment now and ask for strength, even as I will also pray. Ask for strength from the Lord to help you to forgive, to help you to love, to help you to surrender yourself. All things, let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, we come before the throne. The work is so great. And how shall we do the work? How shall we reveal Jesus? We are told, Lord, it is through medical mission. Yet, Lord, we are so weak. We don't even know where to begin. Lord, more than 3/4 of your church has not even heard of medical missionary work. Please, Heavenly Father, work in our hearts as your people. Please, also, with great haste and speed, Father, establish centers for training. And even individuals who are willing to go to the churches and give the training, please, loving Father, please, Lord, we beg. Honor his name.
And even the surrender that we need to make of our lives before we take hold of this word. Help us, Lord, to make the surrender that causes the surrender. Thank you, Moses, for speaking to us. I really pray that you help everyone, Lord, who's listening to the audio and watching the video. Anyone, Lord, who's struggling with self, with sin. All Moses, there is a remedy for the sins of soul. Please, Lord, do not allow anyone to be deceived by Satan to think that they have gone too far to find forgiveness. They have sinned too much in order for them to be cleansed. All this cleansing power, please, Father, cleanse all your children. Please, Lord, from the highest offices, pastors, leaders, elders, laymen, members, everyone, Lord, we need the cleansing blood. We need it, Lord. Please help us. We ask in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.